of all time is an Alabamian, and I wrote a poem about him that all of a group of Ram is going to have a copy of, and it's going to be framed for his family. His name was Bob Jackson. Have you all heard of him? Robert Jackson. His son is now pastor of a large church in Decatur. His name is Robbie Jackson. And Robbie is the head of our organization Ram now. But anyway, welcome to our church. And we have a preacher with us today from the church. He's the leader of the group. I think he's the leader of the group. Is he the leader or not? Okay. And his name is Ryan Tyler. And Ryan will be preaching for us today, and we thank the Lord for his presence and for this. I hope you all got some coffee before you came in, because I got a whole lot of coffee out there. We also had some. I thought it's better, instead of having somebody to administer it, just to say, get your own coffee, get your own donuts. And I hope you're doing that. And so we'll try to have those each Sunday morning for those that come in late, don't come to Sunday school. Maybe we can preach to you back there while you're there. But welcome to church. Good to have you all here. I'd like for the group to stand, if you would, that's going to be working with us. And Ron, you're from what church again?
Highland Baptist.
Highland Baptist Church. Let's give them a hand for coming. You're not supposed to clap for yourself, by the way. You know, it's interesting that we have you here, and we're thankful for that. And I know that Robin Cook is really happy to have you, too, to help out, and all the ones in Bible school. So I'm sure you have talked with her, I'm sure, haven't you? I saw her in there with you this morning, in fact. So we thank God for you. There will be some good things to do, some construction, all those kinds of things. So welcome to our church. Again, let me say that we're to Cloyce and all the family. How sad we are that of the passing of Thel Marie. She was just a special person in every way. And our hearts are broken with you, Cloyce. And we're going to be remembering you and remembering her and the family. At this time, we have responsive reading, and I was wondering, Jim, if you would come up and lead us in this responsive reading and then have our opening prayer. Would you do that for us? It's 694. I think probably it will be on the screen, and if it is, we can read it from the screen. Is it going to be there? Okay, fine.
Good morning. 694, I will read the light, and you read the dark. The Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am a chief. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according unto the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions.
Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin, for I have always sinned against thee.
Against thee only have I sinned, and done this evil in thy sight. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are just so grateful to be here this morning. Heavenly Father, we just acknowledge that you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We know, Father, that we are so unworthy of your love and your grace, but we're so grateful that you choose to bless us in such a way. Heavenly Father, I pray for this community this day, this church this day. We pray for all those needs that are represented in this room and around us. We know you're a God of love, and we know that, Heavenly Father, your word teaches us that we should seek and we should knock, and we should always come to you in all things. We pray, Father, for the Bible school that's going to take place this week, and we thank you for those participating both in this church and community and also for this group from Alabama. And we just pray your blessings and safety and guidance, and that, Father, that the love of the Lord Jesus Christ will be shared through all that is done as a result. And we pray for other needs in this room, and we do especially lift up Cloyce, his family, during this time, Heavenly Father. And we just pray, Father, for your strength, your presence, where times will be difficult. Just make yourself known in such a real way that your strength will help carry Cloyce through, as well as the children and the family and the loved ones. Father, again, we just love you so much. We thank you for all the blessings of life, and we pray for your presence upon this service. For Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Would you stand once again? For his name is wonderful.
Wonderful, isn't it? His name is above every name. Jesus is our Savior, our Master, and our Lord. And when we come on Sunday mornings, even though it's wonderful to meet our friends and others here, we come mainly because we come because Jesus is here, and he promised, "I'm with you always to the very ends of the earth." So it's good to have his presence here. And we know that he's here with us. Sometimes, maybe because of our human flesh, we don't feel his presence as we should. But he promised, and the Lord who promised is always true. When he said he'd be with us always, he meant always. You know, I love these songs, and I love the scripture particularly. As we read about David and his time of sin. But you know something, all of us sin against God and come short of his glory. And so it's good to realize that again and to repent and ask God to cast our sins from us as far as the east is from the west. And that's a long way. All those things I've done that have been bad, God has just taken them and gotten them completely out of the way. Somebody once said that God puts our sins in the depths of the sea and puts a sign up, no fishing. And that's true. He just casts them away from us completely. It's good to be God's people. It's good to know that God loves us, that Jesus died for us. And so this morning, as we have our offering, I wonder, Gary, if you and Jim would come and take the offering. And Gary, would you please lead us in our prayer? Let's be thankful as we pray for God's goodness to us, and we can be good to God by sharing our physical gifts. Gary, lead us in prayer, please.
Dear gracious Heavenly Father, Lord God, thank you for this beautiful day that you've given us, Lord. Thank you for watching over us tonight. Lord, I ask that you, Lord, just do this offering, Lord, and use it for your kingdom. I ask that you do the best in the service of them as well, Lord. And Lord, just ask that you help us, Lord, to honor you in all we do.
Amen.
Doxology. Turn to page 60 if you're following along in the book for Be Thou My Vision. We'll sing first, second, and last stanza. Page 60.
Thank you. Well, I'm just excited to be here today. Just tell a quick story about us. I realize it's really not about us here, but a couple of months back, our church has a relationship with Botswana in Africa. We kind of spent some time over there. And they have gotten to know some of the missionaries
in the field on site. And they, some of the missionaries has actually come back stateside. They're in South Carolina now and involved in a children's ministry over there and just impacting lives of children. And we thought, man, it would be great this summer to be able to go to South Carolina and spend some time with those missionaries that we know and that we've built some relationships with and just help them serve along in their ministry. And so that's what we planned. I mean, really, that's what we planned. We just had everything going. And about May, they called and said, look, fire marshals come in and they've shut down some stuff in our building. And we really don't have an opportunity for you to be with us this summer. And we're like, oh my goodness, what are we going to do? And our church has a relationship with Oneida, I think, the Baptist home there. I mean, the Baptist school there. And so I'm like, well, great. We'll just go there, right? So I call and I go, is there any way that you can take youth group to come and maybe we can do some things? And they're like, we don't take youth groups. And I'm like, Lord, I know you want us to be a part of something this summer. I know you want us to be somewhere investing in lives. I know, Lord, you've got something to teach me and our students. And so I thought, where are we going to go? And I remember in 1986, I had the opportunity to come to Pippin Passage, Kentucky as a youth myself on a mission trip. And I remember staying at Alice Lloyd College. I remember coming to this church 28 years ago. And I thought, hey, let's call Pippin Passage and see if they still have the build. I haven't seen the building, but there's like this Baptist building that I remember painting the outside. And so I'm like, I got to find this place because Pippin Passage for 28 years has been on my heart. Just because of what God did in my life as a 16-year-old young man. And so I called and I got to speak to Miss Martha and she said, you know, we had a group from Georgia planned to be here and they couldn't make it. They pulled out and it's our vacation Bible school week and we don't have anybody. And I said, praise the Lord. I'm so excited that you have the opening and that God's He's kind of worked us through a long ways to get here, but I'm so excited to be back. I pulled in last night and I'm laying in my bed at Alice Lloyd College, and I'm texting some of the guys that I remember coming here years ago, and I remember how God impacted me. Eight years later, I'm standing here. It's exciting to me. But it's not about us. It's not about me. I am truly joyed to be here. Colossians. Paul writes to a people that he's really not met. He spent 3 years 100 miles away in Ephesus, but he writes to these people that he knows about through a friend. And I wish we had a lot of time just to camp out right here and hang out together, just talk about God's word. Pastor said 25 minutes. I go, okay. I gotta be purposeful then, right? So, can we just read through this? And because
Let me open this, because my version of scripture here is a little different than what's on the screen, so we're going to try to match up right here. Paul's writing this to these people, and he has some concerns for them, and he's going to address some of those concerns. You know, Paul's writings, it's not one of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. It's not an eyewitness account of our Lord and Savior. It's not a storyline with parables in there and teachable moments. I mean, his writing is more, it's instruction, it's more teaching, and it's very directed to certain issues of the day. And that's basically what he's got right here. He writes to this church. And so here, let's just read through the first 8 verses. It says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, Timothy, our brother, to the saints and the faithful brethren in Christ who are in Colossae, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 3, we give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus, praying always for you. Since we've heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of your love for all the saints, because of the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, of which you have heard before in the word of truth of the gospel, which has come to you, as it also has in all the world, and is bringing forth fruit, as it is also among you since the day you have heard it and knew the grace of God in truth, as you also learned it from Epaphras, our dear fellow faithful servant, who is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf, who also declared to us your love in the Spirit. I don't necessarily have a sermon title for this sermon today, but I do want to throw some words at you that I think Paul brings out for us to be able to grab a hold of, for us to be able to see and just go, I can hang my hat on those words. I can see what's going on here. So I guess the four words would be love, hope, the gospel, and a disciple. If you can walk out of here going, okay, I know that those four words are right there in those first 8 verses, then maybe we've connected today. Can we just look at what Paul says to this church? I mean, he says, definitely he's praying to the Father, and he gives thanks to the Father for their people. And so I think if I could add words, and I would add being thankful if I could add a word here. But isn't it Paul's example here that when God's at work in the lives of others, that he doesn't take credit for that, or he doesn't want to give credit to certain people there, but he wants to give God the credit for working in the lives of others. And so he says, we give thanks to God for you. But the key word there is in verse 4, it says, since we have heard of your faith in Jesus Christ and your love for all the saints. I don't know if you see that term, all the saints. I think Paul here is pointing out a different community. Paul here, he's saying there's something different about you because you have a love for all the saints, not just some, but all. Not the ones just close by, but even the ones far away. All the saints. And I look at that and I go, man, I love all the saints myself. I mean, what would Paul say to us as a church from Florence, Alabama? Do we love all the saints? Or do we just love the ones that we're familiar with? Do we love the ones that make us comfortable? Do we as a church from Florence, do we love all the saints that we drove past to get here? What would Paul say in a sense about this church? We love all the saints. This is a big word. I mean, Paul's saying to them, this is a marker in your life to see the fact that God is doing something in you. Because all is a big word. Do we love all the saints of the churches that we drove past to come here this morning? Do we love all the saints in the church that we left to come to this church and be a member of? I mean, that's a big word. I mean, the reality of it is, sometimes loving saints is hard to do. I mean, do you know what I'm talking about? I mean, if you're hurt and offended in this world by someone that's lost, don't you somewhat kind of expect that? I mean, you know, but when a brother or sister in Christ, when they hurt you, when they offend you, isn't it a little harder at times? Because don't we have a little bit higher expectations from family to be able to forgive them and move past that and not hold bitter, harbor feelings toward them? Paul says, these folks, they got past it. They learned how to move on and forgive and allow God to come in and redeem their heart and God come in and to continue to give them a love for all the saints. Different states, different parts of the nation, different parts of the world, all the saints. That's a big word. And sometimes I guess I have to look at my own self and I'm not sure. Has God moved in my own heart for me to love all the saints? But these people did. This church at Colossae, they had. And so then I want to ask why? How? Well, in verse 5, if you'll look at verse 5, this is the great thing. He says, the reason that I see that you have a love for all the saints is because where you're placing your hope, where your hope is. And he points out the fact that their hope is this treasure, is this reward, is this inheritance that's laid up in heaven. The reason that they can love other folks is where their hope is. So I guess that lends me to ask the question in my own life, where is my hope for us today? Where is your hope? What is your hope in? Is it in the permanence of this life? I know it's not something we like to talk about a lot, but the truth is we're all going to die someday. And we don't all get to be 99 and die in our sleep. As comfortable as that sounds, I mean, we've lived long enough, right? We know different. We know that chances are in this next year that someone that we're close to, someone that we love, is going to pass away. It's going to take us by surprise. I know the pastor, he mentioned this last week, they've been a part of 2 funerals this week. Our life is but a vapor. And if we're laying our hope up into this life, we're going to be disappointed. Maybe your hope is, I'm just better. I'm better than that guy is. Maybe that's what your hope is. Maybe your hope is that one day you're going to stand before the gates of heaven and you're going to say, God, open up the gates. Let me come in so I can receive the storehouse goods of heaven. Because I'm better than that guy. maybe it's... God, I know that I love my kids more than they love their kids. Is that what your hope is? Is that what you're laying up your hope? Is it that you hope, that you're laying up your hope in the fact that your good is going to outweigh the bad of your life? God's somehow going to say, come on in. These believers, they laid up their hope in heaven because they knew the inheritance. They knew the reward. They knew the treasure that God had for them. It's not based on their good works, not based on their ability to love their children more. Not based on the one with the most stuff wins. It's not a material possession. But it was based on the truth, the Word of God, the gospel. They'd heard it. They believed it. And they took the Word of God. They put it into their life. They laid up their hope in heaven. And it allowed them to be denied some of the comforts of this life. Because they knew that what heaven was going to be like. They denied the comforts of this life so they could love all the saints. They gave up some of their own agendas so they could love all the saints here and now. So they could serve them. So they could honor them. They took their life and they said, this is not all that it is. It doesn't just stop here. There's so much more. There's an eternity in heaven with the Father. Look, I really don't know a lot about Pivot Passes in this area, other than what I think that I remember, and that's very little, right? I mean, it really is. I don't know if you're familiar with Lackawanna, or if you're familiar with some of the different things that churches do where children come in or youth come in, and whether they play a sports game like an upward sports or an Awana, which is kind of a, I don't know, it's a new, it's not new anymore, but I guess it's a different children's ministry idea that they have. And it seems like at the end of some of these Christian new things, that every kid gets this award or gets this trophy, gets this prize, you know, just for being there, I guess. I'm not sure. Maybe this is the way it is in schools. I know it is in schools where we are, you know. I mean, they're giving awards for everything now. This, you know, attendance, you did good, smiley face, this person was great. So that every child seems to get this certificate or this treasure or this reward or this trophy. I mean, I'm not too sure what happened in the days when someone won and someone lost. Someone got a trophy and someone went home without a trophy. I don't know what happened in those days. you know, in real life, someone wins. In real life, someone loses. But somehow we're just giving everybody everything. You're the best. I don't know that if that mindset's kind of creeped into your life, that you think you deserve heaven. I don't know if you think when you get to heaven, God's just going to go, here's your certificate. You did such a good job. I know that Scripture uses the word reward, and I know that Scripture uses the word treasure and gives us some instruction about those. But if we take in those words, if we twisted the meanings from what God's word really is for us so that we think that God's going to give us what we deserve and it be something good, you do realize that the gospel, the word of truth, shares with us God created the heavens and the earth. He created it. Not a big bang. Not years and millions of years of evolution. God created it. He made everything on this earth. He made man. He made man in his own image so you have a relationship with him, fellowship with him. He made woman. And man and woman sinned and it separated God, separated man from God. And that sin was passed down to every offspring. And what we deserve is hell. We don't deserve heaven. We inherited the sin that separated us. And that's what we deserve. It's a horrible story. It's a terrible thing if it stops right there. But the gospel, the word of truth, it doesn't stop right there. God, he set up in the Old Testament, he set up a way for man to be back in a right relationship with the Father through bloodshed sacrifice of animals. And for us, it would be not something that we would want to stomach. If the old covenant law was still in place, and the pastor's bringing animals in, there was blood everywhere, and you're smelling it, and we're sacrificing these animals, we're covering, we couldn't stomach that. The Old Testament, the old covenant, God said, listen, there's got to be shed blood of a perfect sacrifice. Jesus came along. He said, I'll be that blood sacrifice. This is the gospel. This is the word of truth. And Jesus died on the cross, shed his blood, covered our sins, so that we have a relationship with the Almighty God, so that we could be children of the Most High God. So that we one day can, when this earth, this life is over, and we stand before the Father, he can say, not here's your reward, here's your treasure, here's what you deserve. We can say, Father. And he can say, my child, here is the inheritance that I give you that you can't earn. Here's the inheritance that I have for you as my child, because I love you and I created you and I made you. See, it's not just our sin. It's not just our sin, guys, that keeps us out of heaven. It's our goodness too, right? I mean, doesn't Scripture say that even our good things are like filthy rags? Do you realize that it's not our neighbor that's our standard? We don't get to heaven because we're better than our neighbor. It's not our standard. Holy God is our standard. There's nothing we can do to get there. But the grace of God, sending his Son, the word of truth, the gospel, Jesus made a way that you and I could be children of the Most High God. It's the greatest story ever told. There's not a better story. You believe that? You believe the gospel is the greatest story? These folks did. And it allowed them to love all the saints. The gospel story, it's the story that changes lives. It has from the beginning. It's still changing lives today. Do you believe that it is? Paul says, this is my story. I have no other story. I have no other message. It's the gospel. And we get to share it with others. We get to speak that into others' lives. We get to pass that on to them. Excuse me. You know what Paul says? He says, listen, you know how you got it? You know how you, and he's talking to the church of Colossae. You know how you got this story? Epaphras heard it. I got to speak with him, and I got to teach with him, and I got to share with Epaphras. And Epaphras comes to you, and he shares with you the gospel story. And so this is kind of that last word, you know, disciple. How Epaphras goes, and he is the pastor of this church, and he just pours his life into him, and he shares the greatest story ever. He's not getting the church together and going, hey, look, we're going to just share this story. It's a story that we made up. It's a pretty good story. We just like to sit around and tell each other this story. No! This is the truth of God. It is the good news. Man can't get to God. Man will perish and be separated from God himself for eternity. But Jesus made a way. Epaphras says, it's a great story. I want to share it with you so you'll know it. Paul says, you heard it from Epaphras. Today, we hear the story. It's still the greatest story today. No greater story. We get to share it with others. I guess the question really is, who are you being an Epaphras to? Who are you sharing this greatest story with? Someone was an Epaphras to you. A pastor, Sunday school teacher, parent, someone down the street. Someone shared the story with you. And we get to be that to someone else. We get to share that story. Last, this is it. Last verse, 8. Watch what he says. Epaphras shared this great story with you. And he said, who also declared to us your love in the Spirit. He says, listen, Epaphras shares with us, has shared with us about your love. Love in the Spirit. And I guess the question for me, for my own life is, how do I love God like this? How do I love God like this? How do I love other people like this? And I think Paul points out here is we have to love in the Spirit. Because the truth is, if we walk out this door to serve, if we walk out this door to serve just to love people more or to love them harder, I think we're missing the point. Paul says we got to love in the Spirit. How do you love in the Spirit? I think the best way that I can say this is we've got to walk out those doors and love God first. Love God more than we love anything else. To worship Him, to adore Him, to honor Him with ourselves and our own life. We fall in love with God. And we have conversations with God, and we see the fact that God loves us. And that surprises us, right? I mean, if we know God the way that the Scripture teaches, the way that we believe that He knows everything about us, and for God to love us, doesn't that surprise you? Because He knows our good, our bad, our ugly. Doesn't it surprise us that God loves us? And then He starts ministering to our souls, and He goes, you know, I just don't love you. You're my child. You're not just my child. I am your life. And we begin to start to see how God has changed us, made us a new creation. He's put the Christ life in us. And we go, wow, this is the God that I love. This is the God that I want to serve. And we go, God, I want you to give me that kind of love so I can love you back with that. So God kind of gives us a little taste of that love. And we go, God, will you allow me to love other people this way? Love in the Spirit. And so then we begin to start looking at people. And we can see the image of God on them. Because we're created in His own image, right? And when we love God, and we begin to see the image of God on other people, then we get to love the image of God on them. We're the worst of the worst sinners. We can love just the image of God. The worst prodigal, we can love. The saint in that church that has so wounded us, we can love. Because we are loving the image of God on them. We can love in the Spirit. He is a God who loves us. He's a God who loves you. He's a God who loves me. He is the truth. He is the way. He is God. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We want to love you more. We want to know what it means to love you more than anything else. Father, if we need to be changed today by the gospel, by your truth, I ask, Lord, that we be changed. If you need to speak to us, Lord, about our own position and our own standing before you, Lord, if we don't know you as our personal Lord and Savior today, may it be the day that we receive your sacrifice, where we admit that we are a sinner and we believe you are who you say you are and you did what you did for us. We confess our sins. We confess you before men. Today, Lord, if we're already a believer, but yet you've spoken to us about our hope and where we're laying it up, are we loving others? All others. If the good news, if the truth of God needs to speak to our life about that, today, Lord, I ask that we would yield to you, heed your voice, Lord, as we look forward to Vacation Bible School tonight, the rest of this week, the opportunities that the individuals in this room are going to have as they step into their workplace, as they rub elbows with co-workers, that the word of truth, the gospel, the greatest story ever, would touch the souls, the ones who need to know you, ones that need to hear from you. Today, Lord, there's an altar here. If you need to deal with any of us, You are our God. You are our Father. We want to be faithful to you in whatever. In Jesus' name. Amen. Pastor.
We have an invitation. The invitation will be on the screen. And we'll be singing Amazing Grace.
Clyde is one of the, I don't know what you are about, but Clyde is one of the best.
best-known scientists in America in microbiology that's been around the world and lectured in so many places. Love his family is a unique and outstanding man. I just love all his family, all his mother's family. Great people, wonderful people. And so I was talking to, by the way, voice to Bob Orton yesterday. He called your brother-in-law and I asked him about Jordan, and he said that he had told Jordan that Austin Hall and I've told him how brilliant he is. He's one of the most brilliant people I've ever met. And has been on the debate team of New York University, went around the world debating. He was so much smarter than me that I hate to have him in class. I had him in the class and he wrote papers for me that I was absolutely astounded that anyone had a mind like that. And always came up. So God bless you. We're just so happy that you trust in Jesus to save you. We love all your family. Everybody's going to come by, I'm sure. I want you to say to you what you said you should say.
Yes, I'd like to first.
We accept you in the church, and she comes with a letter and so she's got a sister.
If I falter, please bear with anyone that knew Thelmy and me, and the folks of you here that do not know me or know me, my wife, we had an unbelievable love for 57 years. She was such a special person, and her, she loved this church. She loved the members. And her heart's desire was to come here and join. And anyone that knows us in the past know that we were practically inseparable. My brother, Dr. Thornsbury, that Lawrence was talking about, made a statement we were the most married people he ever knew. My son, during our period of trauma, said to me, he said, Dad, you and Mom don't have separate identities. You're both linked. But she wanted to come here, and only I saw folks from the college. Only I was the one that saw each day how much weaker she was getting. But we wanted to do this together. That's why I wanted to speak to you. We wanted so much to walk down this aisle together. My brother Lawrence, her spirit was with me. And we wanted to be baptized at the same time, and we'd even made our plans that it would be Brother Lawrence and hopefully Brother Glenn would baptize us. But the Lord saw how weak she was getting and how much pain she was suffering, and he came and called her home. But just before she went and breathed that last breath and entered paradise, my commitment and promise to her that we will be together again and we'll spend eternity. But she did so want to be here. And I'm doing this also for her. And I know that I have been touched so many times in the last few days with proof of God's blessing and what an awesome God he is. And I wanted to share just one thing with you that happened to me yesterday. I was hurting so badly that, you know, missing her so much, the selfish part of me says, yes, I wanted to keep her. But then the spiritual part of me tells me there's no more pain, there's no more chemo treatments, there's no more surgery, there's no more sticking her with needles, none of that stuff. She's with Jesus now. She doesn't need that. But yesterday I was hurting so bad, and I went back to the cemetery, which is about 5 minutes from my house. And I guess if someone had come along, they'd have thought they probably was a crazy man if they're talking to themselves, but I wasn't. I was talking to her, and I was talking to the Lord. And I told the Lord I need a break. And sitting in my driveway was a white truck. And standing in my driveway
It's my brother Mike Cottle, a great man of God, pastor of Hyman Baptist Church, and he said, I just had to come. Something just made me, I had to come and see you. And he just counseled me, and we talked for forever. And he said, wanted to say a prayer with me, and he just put his arms on my shoulders, and we had prayer. And the folks, to prove how awesome God I think we serve, as we prayed, Thelma's image appeared to me. She was smiling, and I know that she's okay. Thank you, folks, for listening to me, and thanks, Lawrence, for letting me give in. This gives me some bit of closure, and with the Lord's, if it's His blessing and His will, I'll be baptized next Sunday, and He will, she will be there with me, and but she doesn't need that water baptism and all that, but we'll be together again. Thank you, folks, so much for listening to me.
Come around now and help us.